is Robert Hecht. I work here at R4D, and on behalf of our own institute and the Harvard School of Public Health, Suerie Moon is here representing Harvard. Hi, Suerie. And Benn, McGrady, is it? From the O'Neill School. We'll have a couple of panels here to try to tease out the salient findings and recommendations in the report and discuss its significance for the future of health research and development efforts to try to create and improve access to badly needed health technologies for low and middle income countries. I'm also very pleased that the president of our institute, Results for Development, David DeFerranti, is here in the audience. Dave, if you want to put up your hand. Thank you, Dave, for coming, and I think that just reinforces for us the importance we attach to this event and to this whole topic around health technologies meeting the needs of low-income families and communities in the poorest countries around the world. If you have looked at the agenda, you know that we're starting out with John-Arne summarizing for us the key features of this report and setting the stage for the two panels which are going to take place subsequently. John-Arne is a good friend of ours here at Results for Development. We've connected not only on this CEWG process, but we've had the privilege of collaborating with him in other settings in his former life or role, heading up the most prestigious, most important center in Norway on both domestic and global health policy in our projects with him and with the Harvard School of Public Health around knowledge translation in the sphere of health policy. And it's just wonderful, John-Arne, to have you here today talking about the work of the CEWG. John-Arne not only chaired this whole process over the last year, but it's clear from my discussions with him that he remains committed to seeing that there is follow-on to this CEWG process. He may be talking a bit about that as well. Certainly, that'll come out in the discussions. And we're happy that he's spending more and more of his time on this side of the Atlantic, because now he has, I don't know if it's a permanent or it's just a visiting position, but he's a professor at the Harvard School of Public Health. And in that regard, as I say, we'll have more chances to interact with him up in Boston and here in Washington. So, John-Arne, let me hand over to you, give you 15 or 20 minutes to give us the highlights of the report, and then we'll have the first of the two panels that will come up here, and I'll do my best to moderate that. Larry Gostin will be coming about an hour from now and will chair the second panel focusing on this binding agreement or convention that will come out in the discussion. John-Arne, over to you.
Thanks a lot, and thanks for these kind words and for hosting this event together with the Harvard Global Health Institute and Georgetown Law School. As you said, I've had some relations with the R4D in different aspects over the last years, and I really appreciated that. So what I would do is really now, in as quick as possible, try to introduce you to the 218-page report. So kind of just follow the movie coming up on slides. I would like to set it in kind of with a proper background, because this is really about how can we as a world secure investments in research for health in developing countries. And I would like to take you back to the Commission on Health Research for Development from 1990. That was the kind of report that coined the term the 10-90 gap, as most of you have heard about. The idea that only 10% of the R&D investments in health were going to 90% of the disease burden. And definitely an issue that we still haven't been able to tackle. And there have been a lot of kind of both institutional and policy follow-up after that report, but really it hasn't succeeded fully. Then the other report I think is also important to mention here is the Commission on Macroeconomics and Health back from 2001. That was really a report demonstrating that health investments are not only kind of expenditures, they are real investments that can drive economic growth and economic prosperity. It called for increased investments in both kind of health services, health commodities, but also investments in research and development. I would say that if you see the numbers on health aid from 2000 until today, it's a tremendous increase. But we haven't achieved the same, and we have set up new institutional frameworks and mechanisms to support global health aid. But we have not succeeded in the same way when it comes to research and development. So that's the background. Then the process at the World Health Organization regarding these issues. So the interplay between intellectual property rights, access to medicines, or innovation and public health. I won't go into detail, but it started, of course, nothing starts. It all kind of builds on something else. But one way of saying it started was kind of a resolution in 2003, which led to the establishment of a commission on intellectual property rights, innovation and public health. That report delivered 60 recommendations in 2006, which were discussed, and there was definitely a need to discuss them in more detail and negotiate them. So an intergovernmental working group was set up, worked for 2 years, produced a global strategy and plan of action that was almost fully endorsed in 2008 and kind of concludedly endorsed in 2009. One of the elements in that strategy was to set up an expert working group on one of the issues that were not resolved in that process, and that was how to secure financing and coordination of research. And that was definitely a call from, in particular, the African region, which had that as a key priority. So definitely the countries in most need. Key priority coming into the IGVIG negotiations, which they were not able to get as a clear output. That expert working group delivered a report to the World Health Assembly in 2010. The World Health Assembly, just to kind of put it brief, concluded that there were need for more analysis, more inputs from stakeholders, and therefore formed the group that I have had the honor of chairing now for effectively 1 year and 2 months. So the scope of our mandate is really defined in that resolution. We are looking into research and development for health products and technologies related to type 2 and 3 diseases. And that's the terminology kind of established by the Commission on Macroeconomics and Health. But we should also look at the specific R&D needs of developing countries in relation to type 1 diseases. And we have just taken that as kind of the platform. We have not in the report gone into kind of detailing what does this mean, but we've just taken it for granted. We are talking about the specific R&D needs of developing countries when they are mostly having the market. So what's our current investments in this field? And then the only source with kind of quite good data is the G-Finder report, which are looking at a bit more narrow scope, and that's the neglected diseases. So neglected tropical diseases, but also HIV/AIDS and tuberculosis. In 2010, the world invested around $3.2 billion for R&D in this area. We really don't have the total numbers, but this is around 2% of total health R&D. So way below what we'd kind of seen in the 1090 gap. 65% of these resources are from our public resources, and there's definitely an increase since 86 when they had the first numbers. But we also see that it's mainly a couple of few, and this is not demonstrated here, but definitely the US is contributing more than 70% of those public resources. Europe and other high-income countries are contributing the most of the rest, and emerging economies, developing countries, are really very low when it comes to contributions. Then there is 18.5% from philanthropic resources, and in particular Gates Foundation and also the Wellcome Trust. And finally, 16% from industry. And I should say, just to compare that number, 16%, with a total proportion of investments from industry when it comes to research in health in general, and that number is around 60%. So that really demonstrates the imbalances. There are too little private incentives investing in this area. And that was kind of clearly stated by Andrew Witty, the chief executive of GSK, in a journal article in Health Affairs last year, there is lack of research into diseases that disproportionately affect developing countries, and the financial returns are limited, and we need a range of tools, partnerships, and approaches. Or formulated by in a position paper by 23 organizations, just kind of handed to the European Union's process of making a research strategy for the 2020 perspective. Market forces alone will not lead to the development of sufficient, affordable, and appropriate new technologies and goods for these diseases. Public support and public financing are required when public goods are undersupplied by the market. All stakeholders are more or less agreeing, so that's why I put up these two quotes, kind of from industry, from public health organizations, from academia, countries, all agree on this problem. So that we at least we have a platform to work from. Then going into the work of this consultative expert working group, we have based our thinking on some underlying ideas, and I try to kind of summarize them kind of in a very short way here. When the market is really not functioning when it comes to producing research and development through the incentive mechanisms we have, and the most important incentive mechanisms are, of course, patents and intellectual property rights, we say that at least you must make sure to utilize the market forces when it comes to securing competitive prices. So affordable products can best be achieved through free open market competition in production. This requires the so-called delinking of the R&D costs and the prices of products. When you delink the R&D costs and the prices, you need upfront public financing, and that's a key challenge in this area, and I would definitely think we will discuss that more later today. But that's kind of a requirement. And if you do this in a proper way, in many ways, research and development in this area is re-established as a global public good, where there is need for collective action and agreed financing contributions among countries to avoid free riding on that international level. So those are kind of a starting point. And just to illustrate this in a very simplistic cartoon-like way, this is the standard model for development of new products like medicines. The costs in the pre-competitive phase is mostly borne by public investments in academic institutions, in research institutes. Then the development phase is covered by private investments, and the same when it comes to the prices of the final products which are produced. So those are the costs, and how are they recouped in a way? How do we generate revenues for these two streams? Yeah, public funding goes to the pre-competitive phase, and that's through taxation. But then all these costs, both the development costs and the production costs, needs to be recovered through high prices. So that's the way that the existing model operates in the market. And that's as long as the product is on patent. When the product is off patent, we have kind of a situation with open market competition, and we get competitive prices, much lower and more at the margin. But of course, with still some profit for those manufacturers competing. So that's the standard model. What's the alternative models? Okay, we have the same value chain or the same pipeline. I've kind of shaded this in softer colors, just to demonstrate that there is underinvestment both in the public sphere or the public space and in the private phases here. So what can we do to improve? We can increase public investments by subsidizing and moving more of the public investments into the development phase, maybe in partnerships with private sector. The problem that is that we still then don't have a good kind of control on the price level. We're not sure whether we can achieve affordable competitive prices. So the other model would be delinking, securing open license of the kind of knowledge coming out of the research pipeline, but that requires full public investments in that phase, and that will achieve competitive prices. And we say, in many ways, and this is key in the report, is that when you have constrained resources, it's probably more efficient as a total to invest and make sure that you have at least some well-functioning research pipelines and value chains that can deliver products at affordable prices. So it's better to achieve that full delinking in a set of value change instead of going for the subsidy model, because you don't have a policy control on the outcome. So then to what we did, and I won't go into detail, but we have really not reinvented any new work. We have relied our analysis on a lot of different proposals for improvement in this system. There were 109 proposals assessed by the former expert working group. We got 22 new submissions, and we regrouped these in 15 groups of proposals. And I won't have time to really go into detail of those 15, but I just say that we kind of classify them in three groups: a group that met our criteria well, a group that met our criteria less well, and then a group of proposals that were not relevant to our mandate because they were really not addressing R&D incentives or financing. So in short, what are our recommendations? One is what we now call a group of proposals covered by the term open knowledge innovation. And those are open approaches to our research and development, including pre-competitive research, open source, open access schemes, utilizing prices, both end prices, but in particular milestone prices, and utilizing open or equitable licensing and patent pools as a way of sharing knowledge. So our idea is that these achieve both the delinking criterion and they achieve more efficient research processes by collaboration across research entities. Then on financing, we say that governments will need to step up. That's kind of the requirement for increased public investments. But we say also that governments are the best themselves to decide on what kind of financing schemes they should utilize. And we present a menu of schemes, but in a way, leave it to governments to decide at the national level. On the financing recommendations, we, based on assessment of the current investments being more than 3 billion, if we look at the narrow scope of neglected diseases, and looking into the needs of the pipelines of public-private partnerships, we say that the total investment should be at least 0.01% of GDP. All countries should contribute at this level. Most of this funding should be utilized within countries, but to improve coordination and improve efficiency, we say that at least 20% of funds should be pooled at an international level. What's the current state of funding? And you probably cannot read this, but we just kind of plotted a set of countries and their current funding levels for neglected diseases. And this is the target level, 0.01%. And this is, as you see, only the US is meeting this target currently. And I did some calculations over the weekend, actually, because I was intrigued to do that after discussions in Geneva last week. What will this really mean in numbers? And I plotted the blocks of countries: European Union, USA, the BRICS countries, and others. And based on the most recent GDP estimates from the IMF, it's now a bit below 7 billion in total. If you say that 20% is pooled, you will see that these blocks, EU, US, and BRICS, approximately should contribute at the same level. And as I said, only the US is currently meeting almost this target of 1.5 billion from public resources. The EU actually needs to increase by a 5x increase over the years, and BRICS countries really need to step up as well. Then on coordination, we recommend to really fill the gap of knowledge in this area. There is too little information on the current priorities, the current financial flows. We suggest to establish a global health R&D observatory, and we suggest to utilize WHO as an advisory mechanism to set priorities at the global level and to be a convening platform of a network of research funders. Finally, how to make sure that this comes together and is implemented. And this is definitely one kind of issue that will be much debated over the coming weeks. We suggest that there is need for a coherent global framework that combines these mechanisms and recommendations. Conventions are a way for countries to agree in a binding way. We have the Framework Convention on Tobacco Control as an example under the auspices of WHO. But in the environmental sector, there are hundreds of conventions. And a couple of them are also having very clear funding commitments at the international level, including the multilateral fund, which helped reducing the problem of ozone layer depletion, and the Green Climate Fund, which has recently agreed to. So we propose an international convention on global health R&D under Article 19 of the World Health Organization. So the final slide, our key recommendations can be seen and illustrated in this way. We have a set of very operational recommendations regarding how research should be conducted and how allocation of research funds should be used. We need, and that we call kind of open knowledge innovation. We need then financing commitments, which are very clearly adhered to, and pooled funding mechanisms to improve coordination. We need wider coordination mechanisms through information gathering in an observatory and advisory functions. And altogether, this can be seen to constitute a global framework. However, if this global framework should be really implemented, we believe that a solid platform and implementation instrument is needed. And that's the Convention on Global Health R&D. Thank you.
Thank you very much, John-Arne. And I have to say that was a very succinct and I thought a very coherent and compelling summary of the report, in some ways even stronger than the executive summary of the report itself. Yeah. So I think not in any way to diminish the work of the group, but I found this especially valuable and a great kickoff for our panel. So if you'll stay up at the front, what I might do, rather than take comments right away on your presentation, would be to invite the four of the first panelists to come up and to let them actually make some remarks on what you've just presented. So if Judit can come up, Rachel, Paul, and Nils, that would be great. I'll move off to the side here so you all can be in the limelight. Good. We have a wonderful panel here today, and I've discussed with them the format for the next 45, 50 minutes. We're going to try the following. I'm going to ask each of the panelists to take 5 minutes to give some opening remarks, some reactions to what they just heard from John-Arne and what they've read in the report. And in those remarks, perhaps they can pick out a few of their key thoughts about the significance of this report, its most important recommendations, any special errors or omissions or things that you would like to see changed or emphasized differently in the report. But I'm also going to ask the four panelists to be restrained with the promise that they'll have a second and a third chance to speak. So we're going to try to turn this into a conversation rather than a series of set pieces from the four panelists. And so after each one has taken 5 minutes with some reactions, some opening remarks, I'll come back to each one of them and ask a follow-on question and then invite you all to also make some brief comments and ask questions of your own. And then we'll have John-Arne also come back and enlighten us or give us his thoughts on what he's heard. So without further ado, let me turn to Judit first, if that's all right. Sorry, we didn't plan this. This is all spontaneous, so we'll see. Judit Ruiz San Juan is the U.S. manager of the Access Campaign at Médecins Sans Frontières, and an organization deeply involved in this area and with some very well-articulated positions. So, Judit, over to you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for organizing this event. It's really a dream come true to see a room full of people interested on these issues. And 5 minutes is quite of a challenge. We've been waiting for 20 years for a solution. So I would like to speak for hours about this issue. I'm just going to let you know, we have a briefing note that summarizes why Doctors Without Borders, Médecins Sans Frontières think this is such an critical and important report, and why the main recommendation of the report that member states should start negotiating a binding convention on the R&D needs of developing countries is such an important recommendation. So the briefing paper is outside, but if we run out of copies, just shoot me an email. I will be happy to send you electronic versions. It's also in our website. So MSF, Doctors Without Borders, we are a medical humanitarian organization. We are working in over 65 countries, mostly developing countries. And we speak about this issue from a very pragmatic perspective. We basically are treatment providers. We provide medical treatment in developing countries, and we have around 40 years of experience of and frustration of not having the tools that we need and seeing our patients basically lacking access to the tools that exist, or basically not having access to tools that doesn't exist because they are not important enough. They don't have the power to drive research and development to the needs that affects their everyday life. So as I said, we're very pragmatic. We come from a very field-based an experience that's basically have come up to the realization that we know what are the needs, we know what are the problems that are causing the lack of response to these needs, we know what are the solutions, we've seen some of the mechanisms that's starting to work, and we just want the world to seize this opportunity to start giving our patients and our medical doctors in the field the recognition that they need. So what are the needs? The needs are basically medical tools that across a variety of diseases that that are basically fulfill the medical needs of people living in developing countries. So on diagnostics, for example, we need a small, simple to use, robust, reliable, and inexpensive diagnostic treatments and test of cures that can be used at the lower possible level, so closer to the patient as possible. We call that point of care diagnostics. We need them closer to the communities. We don't want our patients to have to drive, walk, take the subway, the tram for hours. And we want the results to be quick, and we want these technologies to be inexpensive. The drugs. We want a well-filled pipeline of new drugs across a variety of diseases. I just came a few months ago. I was in Bolivia and Paraguay, where we're treating Chagas. And our patients are basically being treated with 40-year-old drugs that have a lot of secondary effects. This is unacceptable. There is no test of cure for Chagas. Thank you. Vaccines, 2 minutes. We need formulations and presentations that are available at a low cost, but also adapted. So polio is a great example. Polio has been basically is a success initiative in some sense because it's an oral vaccine. It's been able to be delivered by health workers very close to the community. We want vaccines that are able to be delivered close to the patients and that are affordable. We also want vaccines that are that research and development is done thinking about our patients. So the strains that they are focusing on are the strains that are really affecting that population. We know where the system is failed. I think the chair of the Expert Working Group did it very well, but basically it's a system that links the current R&D system, the way we recover R&D costs, to the final products. This has two main negative outcomes. First, prices are unaffordable. If you rely on high prices to recover R&D costs, you have a problem of affordability. And second, your R&D efforts are focused on the needs of a population that can pay high prices. Therefore, if your targeted population doesn't have high income, you're out of the picture for the current R&D systems. We know how to change the system. We know that the linkage, separating, breaking this link is key. And we know that this is not an esoteric concept. We've seen the linkage applied to a variety of initiatives. We've seen the link can be applied to grants. The link could apply to pull and push incentive mechanisms. We've seen new incentive mechanisms like the priority review voucher, innovation inducement prices, advanced market commitments being tested, being pilot, being launched. And some of them have the linkage on it and some of them don't. We think if we had a global norm that mandate the linkage, the incentive mechanisms that are being tested or piloted could be better designed to meet the need of our patients. We are especially keen on innovation inducement prices because we need new actors into the field of research and development. We need to start rewarding outcomes, not only efforts. And we also want to try ideas that promote a variety of ways of trying to solve a problem. So we like innovation inducement prices, and we're very keen especially on two proposals that look specifically at the needs of developing countries that we are currently treating, TB and Chagas. And as I said, this is not an esoteric convention or proposal. We have seen already practices out there that are good. So our briefing paper shows you very specific examples, concrete examples of what are the needs and what are the attempts that have been launched to solve these needs. So a good example, something that we would like to see replicated, is, for example, the meningitis vaccines project. It was an initiative that was thought with affordability and the needs of the patients that were going to receive this vaccine from the beginning. Therefore, it was developed between PATH and WHO, thinking about what are the kind of vaccines that the patients will need and at what cost are we going to be able to distribute that vaccine as widely as possible. So this is a good example, but we need more examples like this. What is a bad example? In the sense of it's a good example for innovation, but it's a bad example for access, and it's a bad example as a model. GeneXpert is a new technology for TB that we are really, really keen because it's going to accelerate treatment and it's going to bring us diagnostic and it's going to bring us results quicker. Therefore, we will be able to hopefully start dealing with a huge epidemic that's MDR-TB, multidrug-resistant TB, that is facing the countries where we work. It's a bad model because it was never thought with the needs of our patients in mind, in the sense that it was never thought with affordability in mind. And I'm finishing. The technology is highly expensive and we're having problems implemented. Therefore, I'm done. We can talk more about during the question and answer, but this is basically an urgent issue. We've been waiting for more than 20 years, and we could not wait any longer.
Good. Thank you very much, Judith. Thanks for being so concise. And I will come back to you, and we'll ask you more questions and for more views. Let me turn next to Paul Wilson. Paul is a professor in public health at Columbia University. He's an old friend of mine, and among other things, continues to do work for us here at Results for Development. Some of the reports that you probably saw as you came in here on end use and milestone prizes, the work that we've been doing looking at intellectual property and patent pools, different approaches to pooling and allocating donor and public sector and philanthropic funding across a range of product development activities. Paul has had his hand in those and many other things we do here at Results for Development. So, Paul, over to you.
Thanks, Rob, and thanks for setting this up. This is very exciting. And thanks to you and Arne for a very clear presentation. As Rob mentioned, I've been involved in some of the work that Results for Development has been doing in this area, specifically trying to look in depth at some of these specific proposals that have been put forward over the years to address some of the gaps that both you and Arne and Judith have framed very well. And obviously, there isn't time now for me to talk about any of our findings there. I hope all of you will look at the reports. And I will say one thing, though, which is that one aspect that we focused very much on individual mechanisms, especially mechanisms that might use existing funding to accelerate the development of these needed technologies. And of course, to make the whole system work, there's also a very critical set of governance issues, both of the individual initiatives and at the larger level of priority setting and so on. And that's why this report is very exciting and this event is very interesting to me, because clearly, a lot of the discussion today is going to focus on these governance issues and then specifically on the proposal that a binding convention of some type is the way forward there. So I'm certainly looking forward to that. I'm going to use just a few minutes here to introduce three themes, which I think perhaps haven't received as much attention as some of the core issues here, which I think are going to become increasingly important. And I'm going to do that by perhaps deconstructing a little bit the way that this problem is typically framed, and that's as a gap in research and development for products that are disproportionately affect developing countries. And so I'm going to take three parts of that and deconstruct it. First of all, the diseases. I think probably everybody in this room is aware that, in fact, non-communicable diseases are increasingly becoming the most important source of health burden in developing countries, as they have been for a long time in high-income countries. In fact, I noticed that in the Secretary General's report that accompanied the September summit meeting, that the report predicts that by 2030, non-communicable diseases will account for 5 times as many deaths as infectious disease in developing countries. So that's really quite striking. Now, of course, the WHO process and the discussions around this have already acknowledged this for a long time, usually under the umbrella of this somewhat awkward term, the specific needs of developing countries in relation to type 1 diseases. I just wanted to point out, of course, that this is increasingly going to become the most important problem, and it has pretty profound implications for the way we think about these R&D gaps and how to solve them. And I'll just mention a couple things. But first of all, since the burden of disease is shared, you could say there's a good thing there, which is the incentive to develop these products for these diseases in the larger sense exists in many cases because these diseases are important problems in rich countries. But as MSF and many others have pointed out, there's still a very important need for adapted products. And I think even though people in the NCD community are aware of these R&D gaps, perhaps many people working in this area of R&D mechanisms for neglected diseases haven't yet thought about what the implications are for this class of products. The other point I'll make, and we only have time for one more, is to think about what we talk about countries. Developing countries, of course, is a very big floppy term that covers countries in very, very different situations. And as many of you probably know now, if you talk about people living even in absolute dollar-a-day poverty, it now turns out that 70% of those people live in middle-income countries, including half of them in India and China, which are very rapidly developing countries. That has a number of implications. First of all, it means that we can't think about this problem in the same donor-driven way, perhaps, that we have in the past, since many donors are reluctant and perhaps haven't thought about how to assist people in middle-income countries. Second of all, as John-Arne pointed out, there are a lot of implications for the responsibility of these countries themselves to contribute to the solution to these problems, including financially. And also, these countries have, in many cases, substantial R&D capacity and growing. And the question becomes how to harness this capacity. And I'll mention that we at R4D are actually doing a study on India's role in development of new health technologies needed in developing countries. And we're going to be posting a consultation draft of that fairly soon. And I'll just finish on that point by saying that we shouldn't necessarily assume that either governments or firms in these countries are necessarily going to be primarily focused on the needs of the very poor in their own countries. These are countries with large and rapidly growing middle classes who have different product needs, which may more closely resemble those of high-income countries. So that's a very important thing to keep in mind in thinking about what their role is, both financially and in terms of the R&D. And I'll stop there.
Thank you, Paul. Thanks very much, Paul. Can you hear me? Okay, still working. Let me keep moving ahead here and introduce Rachel Cohen to speak next. Rachel is the Regional Executive Director at DNDi, Drugs for Neglected Diseases Initiative, and you're heading up the work here in North America. I think we have the shadow of, or the ghost of Bernard Pécoul here permeating the room with both you, Rachel, and Judit here. But we're delighted to have you with us and look forward to your reactions to the report.
Great. Thanks so much. And thanks for convening this this important discussion, which I think has actually been characterized as something super esoteric and very conceptual for most people. And I'd just like to share the perspective of an organization that, while created by MSF actually nearly 10 years ago, is actually an R&D organization carrying out scientific research, both discovery and drug development. And an organization that's been following this process for the full 10 years in which it's been taking place, at least at the WHO level. Just quickly, for those that don't know, we were created in 2003 by MSF, partly from the Nobel Peace Prize funds that MSF received in 1999, as well as five public sector research institutions, four of which are from so-called disease endemic countries. We never really found the right vocabulary, not quite developing. We don't want to just say middle income. But anyway, our founding partners are the Ministry of Health in Malaysia, the Indian Council of Medical Research, the Kenya Medical Research Institute, and the Oswaldo Cruz Foundation in Brazil, in addition to the Institut Pasteur and MSF. Based on our firsthand experience as an R&D organization, as I said, we're really sharing the analysis of the CEWG report in terms of trends and the evolving landscape in R&D. We've heard a lot of sort of celebratory things in the last couple of years about the positive trends, about new actors coming to the scene, including product development partnerships like DNDi, TB Alliance, and others that are in the room. We've heard a lot about increased resources, including from donors and philanthropic organizations. And while this is all true, it's our view that these are still highly fragmented efforts, in a way very difficult to see under one kind of coherent policy framework, And in other words, it looks like a bunch of piecemeal things that aren't that are little band-aids, but not addressing the larger problem. Overall, I would say that if I had to name two reasons that we're interested in the conclusions of this report and that we think actually there is interesting potential here, is that we believe that there is a very real potential that this effort, that this process could lead to greater needs-driven research and development through enhanced public leadership, and I emphasize the word public there, including an important role, important involvement from disease endemic countries and an important coordinating role from WHO. And because we see this as a possible avenue toward greater sustainability of R&D efforts. Right now, as I said, I think all these advances we've been talking about are very fragile, in fact. And it seems as though, through some of the recommendations in the report, primarily increased and sustained financing, as well as a new normative framework that more closely links innovation and access and disconnects, as people have been saying, de-links the price of end products from the cost of R&D, we think that these proposals have a lot of potential. On a very small and modest scale, DNDi has been actually implementing some of these things on some level. I'll just give one example. We've developed six new treatments since our founding in 2003. All of them are non-patented, easier to use than previous treatments, field adapted and affordable. We consider them to have been developed as public goods. And ASAQ, which is a fixed-dose antimalarial of artesunate and imodioquine, which was developed in partnership with Sanofi, has been developed under a royalty-free, non-exclusive licensing agreement that has allowed, among other things, 130 million doses to be distributed at cost plus a very small margin, which is to say free for the actual patient population. And it's allowed us to transfer the technology via Sanofi to, and we're in the process of this, to an African manufacturer, so that we are not only just producing things in the north, so to speak, and sending them to disease endemic countries, but actually strengthening and utilizing research capacity in the countries in which the diseases are highly prevalent. So I'm sure we'll have more time to talk about this during the discussion, but one other point I really wanted to emphasize is that we do absolutely urgently need more money, sustained sources of predictable financing. But one thing we don't talk about too much is how that money is spent, the efficiency with which it's spent. We have a huge amount of waste and duplication and inefficiency in R&D today. And we think that the open knowledge innovation concept that many organizations are actually implementing and that the CEWG report speaks about has the potential not only to deliver public goods that are addressing genuine urgent health needs in developing countries, but at a much more affordable price. And you'll find a briefing note from DNDi on the table out there. That I just want to highlight one thing in there, which is that we've estimated that based on our business model, that for a new treatment that's an improved modification of an existing drug, it's cost us between $15 and $50 million, whereas for a new chemical entity, we're still working on bringing one through the pipeline, but for a new chemical entity, we're estimating it will be roughly $130 to $200 million based on our experience. That's, needless to say, a far cry from the $1.3 billion that the pharmaceutical industry cites. I realize it's comparing apples and oranges. Much more methodologically sound analyses need to be done. But the point is here, we're not just talking about more money, we're talking about efficiently making use of that money to deliver the best science for the most neglected patients.
What did I do wrong? Thank you very much, Rachel. That was fantastic. This is an amazing panel. Everybody is very disciplined. I must have frightened them when I spoke to them last week. Let me turn to Nils Daulaire. Nils is the director of the Office of Global Health Affairs in the Department of Health and Human Services and has been working in global health for many, many years, including as the CEO of the suddenly defunct, at least for me, suddenly defunct Global Health Council. But it was in its glory days when you were there, so I'm sure there's no connection between what's happened and your role there in the past. Nils, I know there are a bunch of issues here that you also are focusing on and care a lot about. Over to you.
Thank you. And thank you, Rob, for picking at that scab. When I was first trained to be a doctor, we were always told about the bad practice of medicine, which was you start with a symptom and you go right to the treatment. And I think for too long, there has been this sort of symptom-treatment approach to these enormous challenges. What I want to congratulate John-Arne, and I will correct you on the pronunciation, Røttingen, of his last name, and his commission for, is that they have really gone into a much deeper dive on diagnosis, on weighing the alternatives, and at looking at the costs and benefits. That said, this is a process that's been going on for, as noted, at least 22 years since the 1990 Commission on Essential National Health Research. While I think the report is a very big step and a very useful step forward, it's not the end of the road yet, and I think we'd probably all agree with that, but probably see different spots on that road. So let me look at what some of the key issues are here from our standpoint. And let me also note that, to paraphrase President Obama, our views are constantly evolving. I think Paul raises a very important point in describing what is, in effect, the disappearing line between less developed countries and so-called OECD countries, the advanced economies. I think this is very real, and we're seeing it in terms of the growth of non-communicable diseases as a very important burden in low- and middle-income countries. And so while this report focuses on type 2 and type 3 diseases, we really do have to look at it in terms of its likely long-term consequences across the entire spectrum of healthcare, but also recognize that there are some particularly important needs in the lowest income countries and in the lowest income populations, and I'll focus on that. We're very proud that the U.S. is the country that has met the standard set by the Commission, 0.1% of GDP level. This is not happenstance. There's been concerted effort, including from that organization you mentioned, to make sure that there has been real political pressure on investment in R&D for diseases of poverty on the part of the United States government. I'm pleased that this is probably the only area in international development where the U.S. beats Norway. Norway would have to triple its per capita investment in order to match the United States. But I think more importantly, and on a less humorous note, the issue of the emerging economies, the so-called BRICS countries, India would have to invest 5 times what they invest currently. Brazil would have to invest 10 times what they invest currently. And then in that other category that you had, I presume Japan was one of those. Japan, the third largest economy in the world, would have to increase by a factor of 50 its investment in these types of diseases, and we don't even know what China invests. It was not on that list, and we don't know if that's if it's trivial and inconsequential or meaningful, but we certainly know that there are huge additions that would need to come from those areas. And broadly speaking, we welcome and encourage the much greater involvement of all of the world's economies, including low-income countries, in making these investments for the health of their own people, and are very prepared to work very closely with them. In fact, the U.S. is working closely with them. We account for 45% of the total global investment in health R&D and 70% of all government investment worldwide. Over the past decade, the United States has invested almost $13 billion in R&D for these so-called neglected diseases. U.S. government's the leading funder of 26 out of 30 of the most neglected diseases and conditions affecting the developing world. Within that context, it's been a productive engagement in which we've been involved in the development of better than half of the developing country health products introduced in the decade between 2000 and 2010. And are currently working with others to support the development of 200 products that are in the pipeline, more than half of the current new products in the development pipeline, including a possible vaccine against malaria, three HIV vaccine candidates, and a new generation of TB drugs. Now, that's certainly something we're proud of, and it's certainly not enough. We recognize that, and so we do welcome much greater involvement and engagement from around the world. But we also recognize that this doesn't happen in a vacuum. It's not a matter of just add money. You need a robust infrastructure. You need the researchers. You need the institutions to engage with, or else you're going to be, as Rachel indicated, you can be very inefficient with a lot of investment. So we've been focusing on engagement with developing country institutions. I will make my time is up, so I'll cut it short. But we've been working in 600 projects in sub-Saharan Africa with universities and national laboratories through the NIH. And twinning African academic centers with U.S. health centers to help develop these capacities there. And we see this as a third element. The report talks a lot about the financing, and it talks about the coordination. But this very important element of fulfillment efficiency, if you will, of the research is an area where the report touches on it, but we don't feel really goes far enough into what is probably the most essential variable here. Now, in terms of coordination and oversight, and I'll make it quick and then finish up, we certainly agree that delinking the costs of R&D from the cost of the final product is essential in terms of markets where there's market failure. Mm-hmm. We see that this is a very different situation from one in which IP has traditionally played its important and predominant role, and are looking for creative ways to address that. But we also recognize that drug access problems are not limited just to IP concerns. With the development of new drugs, there are additional costs that manufacturers may need to bear, including product registration. Certainly, the issues of regulation, we think, are not irrelevant to these issues. FDA is increasingly working with host country institutions around the world to help them develop their own regulatory capacity, so you don't have to start from scratch every country you go into. Pre-qualifications, marketing, costs of production. These are things that, even totally absent IP, will continue to be important, very often deciding factors in terms of affordability and access to medicines. Finally, we think there are a lot of things that need to be done, including greater need for gap analysis and identification of capacity constraints, and the whole process of research management, which is I think the black box that we're looking at here. We're approaching it from different sides, but this is in many respects an untested hypothesis that a central coordinating mechanism such as a WHO might do this. And when I think about what I'd like to see in such an entity, I'd like it to be nimble, I'd like it to be user-friendly, I'd like it to be customer-centric. Those are not always the words that I use, despite the fact that I am the U.S. representative to the World Health Organization for describing the World Health Organization and its associated components. And so I think we've got work left to do to figure out how to move these very good ideas and the substantial progress forward in ways that will actually benefit the ultimate end user, which is the poorest people in the world living under threat of these diseases. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nils. Let me come back to you right away with a question, since I said I would ask everybody something and then reach out to the audience. Is there more that the U.S. government can be doing to support and to foster thinking about some of these open collaboration approaches that are described in the report. Given there's a lot of U.S. money going into R&D, but most of it is coming in through the traditional push-type mechanisms. And John-Arne's report mentions things like prizes, trying that out, maybe for point-of-care diagnostics where the cost wouldn't be so high, or supporting or maybe trying to get more companies to join the medicines patent pool to see if that can make a difference and so on and so forth. Is there more that the U.S. could be doing? Do you see any possibilities in this evolving, constantly evolving position to move the open source agenda further, open collaboration agenda further?
Yes. Next question. clearly, there's a challenge that we all face when you have large institutions with established track records. Right. If what you have is a hammer, everything looks like a nail. We do have a predominant model, which is the NIH upstream basic research model, and then transfer to private industry. I think NIH itself is making this transition now with some of its efforts to move further into the development stream. And we'd certainly like to look for ways that we can be more proactively engaged with that process, recognizing that sheer market forces are not going to resolve these kinds of problems.
Great. Thanks. Rachel, a question for you. DNDi seems to be already the exemplar, the paragon of doing a lot of the things that are in the report. So what more really needs to be done? Where is the value add in taking on some of these recommendations? And to what extent would a framework or an agreement around this really make a difference to what you're already doing? Or just basically everybody else just have to start behaving like DNDi?
No, absolutely not. I mean, I think part of what I was trying to describe is a series of advances that I think we've all recognized in terms of new approaches, new ways of doing things. I think industry itself has recognized that more open, especially in the pre-competitive space, more open collaboration is the wave of the future, that new kinds of business models need to be tested, that the current system is unsustainable for industry itself. So I don't think there's anything particularly radical here. It's beautiful to see it all in one place. And I think for us, while we have already managed to enter into quite progressive agreements with many pharmaceutical companies, and we are participating in WIPO research to the extent that that will ever be useful, we believe in the kind of utility of the medicines patent pool, especially for developing pediatric formulations of HIV, which is something we're working on. I think the short answer to the question is that we do see the need for. All of these successes have been extremely limited, extremely individual, very fragmented, and we would feel much more confident about the sustainability of our own efforts to deliver better treatments for people with sleeping sickness, leishmaniasis, Chagas disease, filarial infections, pediatric HIV, and so forth, were there to be this enhanced public leadership on the one hand and this guarantee of some sustainability on the other. And again, the two dimensions of that sustainability are the predictable financing and the new normative framework. It's our view, and I know it's the next panel's discussion, but that the best way to guarantee that is going to be through some kind of, you know, R&D framework convention of some kind, just because that tends to be how states make a series of commitments to one another and to one coherent set of obligations. But it's entirely possible to pursue some of the proposals outside of the scope of a framework. We just believe that a convention is going to be the most effective way to go about doing that, and we do believe it will have an impact on us, and we still have a lot of work to do. Not suggesting at all that DNDi is the exemplar, just we have some experience that I think could be relevant for the discussion.
Great, thank you. Paul, just to toss one in your direction, any sort of a framework or a multilateral agreement, especially if it binds all the countries of the world, is going to take some time to be put in place if it does materialize. In the meanwhile, for your money, any thoughts on where we all should be focusing to make significant incremental progress against the master list of proposals or the various ideas that are out there in this space?
Well, that's kind of a wide open question. I think that, I agree with you that the sort of all-encompassing solution we're not going to have soon, and I also agree with people who've said that quite a lot of progress has been made in recent years, and the question is whether this is sustainable, and it's certainly not enough. Just drawing a little bit on our own work, I mean, obviously we think that some of the mechanisms which the working group itself has recommended could make quite a bit of difference in some areas, and we think the prizes are, by the way, we should make clear that I don't think prizes should replace grants or are better than grants in all circumstances, but we think that they can do, they can fix certain types of problems, and for certain types of products, certain types of R&D challenges, they can make quite a lot of difference. And I think we do need to think about other sources of financing, which could even be fed into the current system. We haven't really talked very much about that so far, but I was very happy to see the kind of endorsement of something like a financial transaction tax. And that's, too, of course, something that would take a long time to put in place. But I think that part of the problem with the sustainability of the current system is the dependence on a very few sources of financing. And it would be nice to have something broader in place.
Great. And Judit, we've heard, I think, certainly implied, if not explicit in John-Arne's presentation, the message that quite a few countries need to pull up their socks or need to do more to reach these kinds of this 0.01% GDP target, quite a few of them in Europe and the BRICS and so on and so forth. Any thoughts from you, from MSF, in terms of that point of view, and what can be done to try to move that process along?
Sure. We completely agree that there needs to be a step up by a variety of countries, including the countries where we're working, on taking health specific in these countries more seriously and investing more. But I do completely agree that more money is needed, but it's not only about money. So because we are in the US, the US is spending a lot of money, and I agree with you, I prefer to focus on how this money needs to be spent. So yes, there needs to be more funding going to research and development, but the way that money is spent, it has to change. So the U.S., I will put, if we're like a class, I will give you 8 or 7 on the level of funding comparing to other countries. But I will say right now you're failing on the way you're investing this money, because it's only thought from a very top-down, donor-driven model. You're mostly investing on traditional ways of doing R&D that you know is going to fail, and is failing developing countries. You're not really promoting research and development capacity. You're not really doing technology transfer in the countries where these diseases are affecting the population. And you, basically, the United States government has been one of the main actors blocking these negotiations in the past. When you, basically, it's not controversial. I mean, the scope of this report is very small. I mean, we're not talking about changing the whole research and development system. The scope, the mandate of the expert working group was very limited. It's mostly type 2, type 3 diseases, and adaptation of type 1. So US is putting a lot of money into it. It's not controversial. The scope is limited. We don't want to change the whole R&D system with this specific exercise. And therefore, I just don't understand why we're not moving forward, and we're not saying this is just the beginning of a process. This is not the beginning of a process. We've been waiting for this for 20 years. When the campaign, Access Campaign, where I work, was created in 1999, in the speech where we were created, this issue was already recognized as a problem. Our patients have been waiting for many years, and still we're still arguing and basically, I think, looking for excuses. I think time is off. I mean, we have a process that is saying that there is mechanisms that work and there are mechanisms that don't work. The ask to the US government is to allow the process to open, and to, yes, we want more money to be invested, but also to allow this money to be spent differently. We want to start linking R&D funding to the real priorities, to the real needs of the people that are going to be beneficiaries, and we want to have an opening on the way this money is being spent. So if you look at initiatives of what is coming from the US government, the priority review voucher, patterns for humanity mechanisms, all these new incentive mechanisms are all about subsidies to the big players, are all very top-down thinking. And what we're asking is a bottom-up, demand-driven, not donor-driven, patients-driven way of doing research and development. And it should not be controversial.
Thank you. Thank you, Judit. Do you want to respond to that now, Nils, or do you want to?
No, I want to respond.
Okay, please, go ahead.
Judit, I'm sorry. I spent 20 years of my career
not in Washington, not sitting in an office doing advocacy, actually providing health care to patients in the poorest countries on three continents. And so I do take umbrage that the U.S. is going about this all wrong. Certainly, there are elements that are, you know, top-down, but what I was just saying right now, 26, the leading investor in 26 of the 30 most neglected diseases. Perhaps your feeling is if we're not doing all 30, then, or leading in all 30, then we're not doing our job. That we've been involved in the development of 24 of the 45 products used in developing countries for people living in poverty with diseases between 2000 and 2010. That's not sort of an arm's length sort of working against the benefit of the people. The very significant investments we have with African institutions, with academic institutions, with the institutions that actually have the potential capacity to develop on a national sustainable basis, this capacity. I think your talking points are totally off base in terms of where the U.S. is. That's not to say we can't do better. I completely agree. But to say that the U.S., which is the major investor in this area, that is the only one that meets these goals, is the block here, I think that you need to move past that kind of language to be productive. Perhaps if the U.S. were investing a tenth as much as, for instance, France is, then we wouldn't, you wouldn't be saying that the U.S. isn't doing enough.
Thank you, Nils. We'll come back to all of that. And we have about 15 minutes. Let me turn to the audience. Please come on up to the mic. Sorry to make you jump out of your seats. Brief comments or questions. Let's see if we can do three or four and then
sure.
Turn back to the panel and to John-Arne.
Sure.
Please. And identify yourself, please. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Claire Wingfield. I'm with PATH. And I really want to commend the CEWG for this really a mammoth job that you did going through all of those recommendations, which I think a lot are things, I think, to Rachel's point, DNDi at PATH, we certainly implement a lot of those pieces. And for us, our private sector partners are incredibly important, not just the big, huge pharma, but also the small biotechs and also the manufacturing partners and countries. So one thing that I struggle with is this idea of how are we incentivizing these important partners, these private sector partners, to continue to invest when they can't do any cost recovery? So I don't even mean, you know, just so that their payment of, or even to bring their manufacturing facilities up to GMP standards. How are we actually going to continue to incentivize if it feels like the entire burden then falls on the public sector for funding R&D? So I would just love to hear a little bit more about the thinking of how this delinkage and how do we continue to engage private sector, recognizing that they're a very important partner in R&D.
Thank you very much. Please.
Hi, I'm Heather Ignatius from the TB Alliance, and my question is for Dr. Daulaire. I'm just wondering, you've talked about a number of different ways that the U.S. government is helping low and middle income countries to contribute more in this space. And just wondering what the government is doing as well outside of the CEWG process to encourage other donor governments to meet their share.
Thanks. Please. And we could take one more if somebody else wants to come up to the mic.
Hi, Eileen Quinn with PATH. Thank you for a very interesting discussion. My question has to do with the model cited in the report, the Tobacco Convention, the climate change, very different markets, players, and this market is also very different, and the set of players. And I guess one of the questions, and perhaps Paul would be the best to address this, what are the potential opportunity costs of pursuing a convention, particularly in light of what might freeze other efforts to find solutions in the time it might take to reach agreement on a negotiated instrument? Thanks.
Thanks. And sorry?
I did want to give other audience members a chance to ask, but it seems that I'm the only one, so I'll abuse my privilege here. So first, I want to thank, my question is for Nils. I want to thank you first for, as a co-organizer, for coming and participating in this event. You mentioned the NIH, and I think that as an American, I can be very proud of the work that NIH does, and particularly the obligation for publicly funded research to be made available, open access, once a certain period of time has passed. And I think that has been one of the most important contributions that the U.S. has made to science worldwide, and there are many people in other countries who appreciate that. You also mentioned that we don't even know how much the Chinese government is, in fact, investing in these diseases. There's not a lot of transparency. So I'm wondering, I think that the U.S. public has a strong interest in seeing information and knowledge that's coming out of R&D done elsewhere also being put into the public domain. How can the U.S. government incentivize or obligate or encourage other governments to do so, such as the Chinese or the Brazilians or the Indians, especially moving forward when more and more research is going to be done in those countries? Is there an alternative to a binding legal mechanism, international legal mechanism, to achieve sort of open access norms worldwide?
Thank you very much. Let me turn back to the panel and give everybody again a third chance or a fourth chance in some cases. If you could just make brief remarks on what you've heard on maybe one of the questions, and then I'll ask you and Arne to give us all the answers. Rachel?
I mean, I think in terms of private sector partners, Claire, there's no question that incentives need to be developed in such a way that keeps them in the game. But I think that we're talking about an entirely different story here. When you're talking about basically almost entirely publicly funded research or philanthropically funded research, to then tie up in that the question of how industry is going to get recouped for their investments is for me problematic. Not to say that we shouldn't have interesting incentive schemes, and I think many have been discussed here today about how to make sure that biotechs in particular, you make a very good point, it isn't just big pharma, that biotechs are in the game, so to speak, and that they don't walk away from global health research and development, that big pharma has more than just a sort of PR value to bring to the conversation about investing into drug research and development. And I do want to say, I mean, I know those of you who've known me for more than 10 years know that I used to be very much banging on the tables, and I will continue to do that happily. But there's no question that that having access, and for example, I mean, many of the product development partnerships here have access to compound libraries, have access to knowledge, have access to research data that is sometimes unpublished. These things are crucial for furthering R&D, allowing follow-on research, for making sure that all of this knowledge that we're generating in an area that historically is kind of shrouded in secrecy and the concept of being proprietary around knowledge, we all have an interest in seeing that is more open, that we're more, I mean, again, it's not only for the scientific process that's going to be a positive evolution, it's for, on the financial side, it's for the efficiency gains that you're sure to see when people are sharing rather than duplicating information. One thing I thought you were going to ask, and you mentioned it, Nils, and so I'll just take my last couple of minutes here to say, I know. I do
minutes.
Actually think the issue of regulatory harmonization and so forth is definitely, we see it as definitely within the scope of the mandate of the CEWG. I know that it was determined not to be, but I think that in terms of the cost, the implications for patient access and so forth, a more streamlined approach to regulatory issues around R&D, especially where regulatory systems are so weak, is an essential part of the conversation. So we'd like to see that discussed a little bit
Thank
more.
Thank you very much. Thanks. Paul, one last thought?
Only one?
Only one. Good one.
Well, I mean, just a couple things quickly. I mean, one is when we talk about incentives for the private sector, as you mentioned, it's not just the big firms, it's also biotechs. And then it's also firms as well as public sector researchers in developing countries. And I think we need to think more about what kinds of incentives are there going to be important there. And they may be different in some cases, they may be the same. Second, I'm going to intrude a little bit on the discussion between Nils and Judith, and just because I think there's the meningitis vaccine project, which I'm also an enormous fan of. I think it's worth pointing out that the technology which made that possible was developed in the U.S. government and was licensed in a non-exclusive, essentially royalty-free mm-hmm. way. That doesn't mean that the U.S. government is handling IP in all ways appropriately, but it made a very important contribution there. And finally, for Eileen, I don't really have anything to add to the way you framed the question yourself. I mean, obviously, it would be a catastrophe, even if we end up with a fabulous agreement if the next 5 years we stopped working on incentives for the private sector, on regulatory changes which would make things work better, that we let the PDPs run out of funding and so on. We have to continue with what's working now and make it better, while at the same time we think about a more sweeping solution.
Thanks, Paul. Judith?
Yeah, I just want to say that this is a very limited report, very limited mandate, and very limited opportunity. And it is for us urgent to basically start acting. So my point was like, let's stop talking, let's start opening negotiations. It's true the US government has done a very important contribution. It's true we live the last 10-20 years of revolution. There are many other global health actors have done a very important contribution to the global health of developing countries. However, the truth, and I've been involved in this process for the last nearly 7-8 years of my life, is that the US government has been blocking the establishing of global norms on these issues. While they are doing unilaterally a lot of good things, they're investing, they are doing more research and development, focus on the needs of the truth is that they have not allowed global norms on these issues to move. And this process is about that. This process is about other countries doing better, and also the US government looking at incentive mechanisms in a different way. This is about efficiency. This is about putting patients' needs first. This is about not only the US government thinking they can solve all the health needs of the developing world. It's great that you're investing so much, and we want more US government investment. Don't take me wrong, but if you look at the budget of the Obama administration for 2013, we're not seeing an increase of the budget, we're seeing a decrease. And I know this is not your fault. I'm saying this is the world that we live. So if you have to start thinking about a different way, that it's not a piecemeal approach, basically. It's not like country by country. It's more about how do we create a global system that will create sustainable sources of financing, that will create open systems of innovation, and that will ensure that access and patients' needs are first. You should open a space, a WHO or whatever you want, for a global negotiation to start and global norms to start. And the reality is that for me, the US government has been looking at it from a very US government perspective, very donor-driven, and not allowing other actors to get into the field and not allowing global norms. And the reality is that the US government has been one of the main blockers of this process in Geneva. And we are hoping for much better from the US government at this World Health Assembly, because we know that this is an opportunity that is not going to last forever. We're not going to have this momentum where basically the R&D needs of developing countries are not always going to be high in the agenda. They are not all there are many other competing interests. So if you have an opportunity at this World Health Assembly in May, in a few weeks, let it move. Let these negotiations start. Let other countries think about what they are not doing well, and let the US government be a little bit more self-critic with what they are doing good and what they could improve. Let that negotiation, that conversation start. That's the only thing we're asking for.
Thank you, Judith. And Nils.
Judith, I'm glad you framed this in terms of the last 7 or 8 years. You probably noticed there was a change of government partway through that process. I serve a different president than the one who started this dialogue. And let me say that the U.S. is absolutely positively in favor of establishing global norms, engagement with other countries. We have established a very different tone in Geneva from what had preceded. We're not always going to agree with other countries. We realize that there are interests involved that have to be dealt with, but we think that a productive path forward is to begin to identify steps to which member states are willing to commit. And as we move towards the World Health Assembly in a couple of weeks, we're going to be discussing ways in which a process of consultations hosted by the Secretariat with member states could allow a process to move forward. Where that ends up, I can't say, but I can assure you that this is not an administration that believes that the United States should determine what everybody else does. We are happy to do our share. The question that Heather raised, what are we doing with other governments? This is, of course, a challenge. It's more carrot than stick. We're dealing with it. I'm leaving tomorrow for the board meeting of the Global Fund to Fight AIDS, TB, and Malaria, where, again, trying to get other countries, particularly the BRICS countries and some of the large oil economies, to do more in terms of contributing to a very different part of the spectrum on healthcare and in low-income countries, the treatment process for AIDS, TB, and malaria, really needs to be, that funding needs to be diversified. The NIH, the FDA, the Centers for Disease Control, and the Department of Health and Human Services itself, all of us in tandem are working with partner governments. We have staff in over 90 countries right now, and the ongoing process there is not doing for, but doing with, engaging them, looking to develop internal capacities and internal commitments to be moving more actively, both among emerging middle-income countries and low-income countries. So, you know, this is a dialogue that it's a generational dialogue, not a one-week dialogue, but it's one that we're very actively engaged in. And we believe that we need to do better as a country, as a government. We need to be more thoughtful and efficient in terms of the way we move things forward. But we also have to serve as a model for others to be able to move forward themselves. So don't mistake the differences that we may have over specific modalities with an unwillingness to engage. That's what international negotiations are for. Sometimes people have to feel that you're up against a wall before they can move forward. Sometimes you can do it over a very easy handshake. That's why I love dealing with the Norwegians.
Thank you very much, Nils. Fantastic. And let me turn finally to John-Arne. In 3 minutes, you'll sort all this out, I hope.
First of all, I would really like to thank for the encouraging feedback from all panelists and also from the audience. And I can say that on behalf of this quite diverse group of 20 experts, and I will feedback that to the group. Then I would actually like to step a bit outside of the role of being chair of that group and try just to speak as an engaged kind of citizen and academic in this area. I think what I started saying, there's an agreement on the problem. What I'm tending now to hear here and in Geneva last week, there's also an agreement on norms and principles. The issue of delinking and the issue of the market failures need to be corrected by other mechanisms. I think that's great. But there is still kind of more work to be done regarding making public financing really come through in a proper, coherent way and agreeing on an implementation mechanism. That needs negotiation. I would absolutely give Nils that point, that needs to develop. There are deficiencies in the report. From my perspective, I would have loved regulatory harmonization being seen as a part of a larger framework. That I couldn't manage to get that into the total set of recommendations, but otherwise I think it's good. We should also have focused more on capacity building. But in the end, I would like to say the following. I'd implicitly deal in what I said. I kind of acknowledge the US as a main contributor. I would say explicitly, that's great. The second largest government, though, government in kind of one way of thinking about it, is a very nimble and very kind of efficient lean government, and that's the Gates Foundation. And that's also tremendous what the Gates Foundation have done in this area. But tomorrow, the Gates Foundation can decide to go, all our efforts would go into education. And of course, that is also good, because there are needs in other sectors. But we really don't have a mechanism that can really correct for that potential change in priorities. And that's what this is about. And I would say that in kind of all countries, we have an agreement on the need to invest in public goods. Now, and we do that through taxation and revenue generation. All tax residents are actually agreeing on that. And then, of course, there are debates on how much and so forth. But we don't have that at an international level. And I think when we are agreeing on the problem, agreeing on principles, and treating this as a global public good, we also need to institutionalize a mechanism where actually countries can be seen as tax residents of the global community. I think that's what we are suggesting by this very clear financial contribution, and that's the way forward. And I think US has really demonstrated leadership nationally in investing here. What we really need now is the US to try to get the other countries follow. Mm-hmm. That's about creating followership. That's another way of leadership. That's an international leadership. And I'm really looking forward to the World Health Assembly to see that demonstrated.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. I'm not going to try to summarize this panel because I couldn't do it probably adequately. That's a tribute to all of our panelists. It was a very, very rich discussion. In any event, we're going to have a very good second act that's going to start in a minute with Larry Gostin coming up here and moderating a panel on this binding agreement or convention. Let me just thank Rachel, Paul, Judit, Nils, thank you all very, very much for coming and being so eloquent. Thank you, John-Arne, for kicking it off and for pulling it all back together at the end of this session. So if you will, please join me in thanking this panel. And let's move on with the second part.
I'm Larry Gostin. I'm the faculty director of the O'Neill Institute for National and Global Health Law at Georgetown University Law Center. I would like to thank John-Arne and his magnificent committee. I would like to thank Results for Development Institute and all of you for being here. We've heard in the last panel a set of normative judgments, and I think John-Arne is right that there is a very broad agreement on the norms, but I think less agreement on the institutional and normative and legal framework for implementing those norms. I've been doing a lot of work and thinking about the issue of how you can mobilize an international community, which involves mostly governments, but also their partners in the private sector, civil society, and others, around really key global governance objectives, and clearly assuring that essential vaccines and medicines get to those in need, and that the research agenda is driven by the burden of injury and disease is extremely important global health governance objective. The question is, of course, whether this takes the form of some kind of a soft norm, like a code of practice or a global strategy, a hard norm. And if a hard norm, should it be in the form of a framework convention? Framework conventions have very much to commend them in the sense that they allow for broad principles to be agreed upon by the international community, and then saving the many of the political controversial ones for future guidelines and protocols, which is exactly what's happened with the Framework Convention on Tobacco Control, which, although not perfect, has been a considerable success, and particularly in rallying in a bottom-up way civil society through the Framework Convention Alliance. There have been many other proposals for framework conventions. One of the most important, we like to think, is one that's being formed by what's called JOLLY, the Joint Action and Learning Initiative for National and Global Responsibilities for Health, which is for a framework convention on global health. And if we were to ever see the dream of a framework convention on global health, I would think that this particular issue, research and development for health, would be a central part of it. So we very much welcome this. The UN Secretary General has actually endorsed the Framework Convention on Global Health, and so there is a head of steam behind us. We have a wonderful panel here to discuss these issues, and the first person on the panel is Suerie Moon, who is the research director and co-chair of the Forum on Global Governance for Health at the Global Health Institute and the Harvard School of Public Health. She's also co-director of the Project on Innovation and Access to Technologies for Sustainable Development. And her talk is going to be on global governance mechanisms for health, including international lawmaking. So thank you.
Thanks very much. I think
I have to shut that off.
Okay.
Thanks very much for the introduction, Larry. Let me first just give a quick introduction to what is the Forum on Global Governance for Health at the Global Health Institute, because it is, in fact, a new initiative. And what we're focusing on there is the nexus of global governance for health, and we're looking at both the positive and negative ways in which global governance processes can impact health and ways in which to improve existing institutional arrangements. So the issue of R&D, as Larry has just quite eloquently put it, is, of course, one of the most central issues of concern today at the intersection of global governance and health. Before I jump in, I just wanted to thank my colleagues at R4D, Rob, Jean, Soma, and Edith, and of course the big boss, David DeFerranti, who I think was here earlier, as well as my colleagues at Georgetown, Larry, Alex, who I'm not sure is here, as well as Benn, my co-panelist. It's been a real pleasure to work with all of you to put this event together. And of course, all of the speakers who've traveled to come and present. I wanted to thank all of you for taking the time out of your busy schedules to be here. So I want to go over five key points, so I'll try to spend not more than 1 minute on each. And let me start first by talking about what is the policy problem. I think we heard a lot about this on the first panel, but just to raise a couple of concrete examples from recent memory that may help to illustrate a bit more what we're grappling with. First, if you remember in 2009 when the H1N1 pandemic hit, it spread to 212 countries within 8 months. Unfortunately, the response was not nearly as fast or as efficient as the influenza virus itself, because many countries spent time fighting over vaccine stockpiles, over the price of antivirals, over stockpiling policies, and how such drugs and vaccines would be shared. And unfortunately, this was something that impeded a rapid and equitable response. Second, recently, about a month ago, the government of India issued its first compulsory license on a cancer drug, and it did that because the price of the drug was about $5,000 per month, and there was a generic firm that could make it for about 3% of that price. This was something that I think was widely considered to be a justifiable move by the Indian government to improve access to medicines for its population, but of course, I don't think anybody wants a system in which we always have to rely on compulsory licensing in order to make sure that medicines are available. I think the third point that I would remind us all about is that we live in a world in which 80% of the population lives in low and middle income countries. So the report was, of course, talking about needs in developing countries, but what we're really talking about here is a global R&D system and whether or not that global R&D system meets the needs of a global population. And if it does not, then what are some of the shortcomings that need to be addressed? So that takes us from the policy problem to what I would call the global governance problem. And what we see in the existing R&D system is a problem in terms of three major areas. One is a problem, of course, of no sustainable sources of financing. The second is no fair system, sort of globally, equitably agreed upon rules for how to share the burden of finance, with the issue around middle-income countries in particular gaining increasing attention. And third, the problem of coordination. How do we set priorities? How do we make sure we share information as rapidly and as efficiently as possible? And how do we improve the overall efficiency of the R&D system? I would characterize all of these as global governance problems that require some kind of global governance solution. Sometimes these ideas can seem very abstract or esoteric, as Rachel said, so I thought it would be useful to draw a quick analogy, which is imperfect, but I think still quite useful. And let us think about the National Institutes of Health again, the NIH, which was mentioned already this morning. The NIH has had major benefits, offered major benefits for scientific research. One of the main reasons we have so many new AIDS drugs and a growing generation of new cancer drugs today is because of investments that NIH made years ago. Every member of Congress, I think, supports the NIH because they all know that they're going to get sick one day and die. The NIH, as I mentioned in my question, makes its findings publicly available, and that's $30 billion worth of research every year that's made available as a global public good. Now, imagine if the NIH did not look like what it does today. Imagine if we had instead 50 mini NIHs in each state. Imagine if each state in the United States could make its own funding decisions every year, and it could decide on what the priorities were, and every year the amount of funding from that particular state might fluctuate. Imagine if some of the states required that the results of publicly funded research be published while other states didn't. I think it's quite obvious that that kind of system would be less efficient, less effective, less stable, and overall less productive than the system we have today, where you do have coordination capacity and policymaking capacity that is centralized. Now, of course, we do not have a global government at the international level, and so I'm not proposing that what is created is a global NIH, but what I am suggesting is that there is a need for national governments to get together to solve the problems that come up when we think about a problem of 50 mini NIHs. Let me just wrap up with my last point, since I'm running short on time, and discuss the issue of binding norms versus soft norms. I think there's definitely pros and cons to binding norms. Some of the negatives are that the process of getting to binding norms is lengthy, it's complex, it's costly, and that once the rules are negotiated, they can be quite sticky. Of course, soft norms also have their drawbacks. They can be precarious, fluid, vague, and virtually non-enforceable. What are some of the benefits of binding norms? They have greater normative force in most cases. They can be more enforceable, particularly at national level, once implemented into national law in countries that operate under that system. And the process of negotiating those binding norms themselves, as Larry mentioned, can be an extremely useful way of getting consensus among a diverse set of actors at the global level. On the other hand, soft norms offer the advantage of often allowing more ambitious or progressive goals to be articulated. So is it the time for us to turn to binding norms on the issue of R&D? I don't think that binding norms are the right solution to every problem. But when there's a critical mass, when the underlying soft norms are there and have been developing, as they have been in this field for the last 20 years, it may be time to take advantage of the benefits that binding norms bring and move away from a system that relies purely on soft norms that, as we know, are less enforceable and have less force than binding legal mechanisms. It has been possible in the areas of intellectual property, trade, environment, investment, and security to reach binding norms and to, in fact, create a number of international agreements. So what this reflects is the fact that when governments have the will, when the priority on the issue is high enough, it is absolutely possible for governments to reach agreements on binding norms, oftentimes with sanctions, to achieve mutually agreed upon goals. So let me close there, since my time is up, and just add one last comment. I do think it is time to move to a system of codification and solidification of the soft norms that have been emerging over the last 20 years into a system of binding norms. But that system of binding norms should not happen at all costs, and there are four things that we'll need to ensure get into any R&D treaty that's negotiated. One, the resulting products have to be affordable. We cannot compromise on affordability. Second, the system of finance has to be sustainable. Third, the system has to improve on the efficiency of the existing system, primarily through open access and sharing of knowledge. And fourth, the priorities have to be based on health and health needs. So I'll close my comments there. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. That was very, very helpful and thought-provoking. Our next panelist is Georgetown and O'Neill's own Benn McGrady. Benn is the director of the O'Neill Institute's Initiative on Trade, Investment, and Health. He's also an adjunct professor at Georgetown University Law Center and teaches a number of courses. He's fairly recently had a book published, which is a sensational book, the best in the field for sure, on trade and public health. And he looks at the WTO, tobacco, alcohol, and diet. I don't know anyone in the world who knows WTO law and health as well as Benn does, and so we're delighted to have him here and at the Institute.
Thanks, Larry. Is that on? Yep. Thanks, Larry, and thanks to everyone involved in putting this together for the opportunity to be here today. I was asked to say a few words about the similarities between R&D and tobacco control. I spoke with a few people about it in advance and got some furrowed brows, but as we've heard earlier today, the One similarity between the issues that are being discussed is that there's a proposal on the table for negotiation of a binding R&D treaty, and the one exercise of the World Health Assembly's power under Article 19 of the WHO Constitution to create treaties has occurred in the context of tobacco control, in the form of the Framework Convention on Tobacco Control. So in the 5 minutes I have, I'll say a few words about what that treaty is, describe it, and the minimal obligations set out in it, and then give some explanations of the functions that it serves and compare them to the functions that an R&D treaty might serve, to see, while there may be no sort of substantive similarities between tobacco control and stimulation of R&D per se, but to look at whether or not these treaties might in fact serve similar functions, and they might be similar in that sense. What is the Framework Convention on Tobacco Control? It's a binding international treaty, now with 174 states parties, and it establishes minimum international obligations of a binding character to engage in tobacco control. So obligations to implement tobacco tax measures, tobacco packaging and labelling measures, restrictions on advertising, promotion, sponsorship. They're all examples of some of the minimum obligations established by the Convention. The basic framework laid out in the Convention itself is supplemented by guidelines for implementation and optional protocols. Optional protocols in this context being themselves binding international treaties under the head of the Framework Convention. And to date, the parties have negotiated one optional protocol on illicit trade in tobacco products. The Framework Convention was a product of very contentious negotiations. There were a number of states at WHO that opposed negotiation of the convention and sought to water down its content throughout the course of negotiations. And it's fair to observe that the United States at the time was one of those WHO member states. The negotiations occurred between 1998 and 2003. So let's move then from that very broad brush description of what the convention is to explanations of it in more functional or theoretical terms. It's fair to say that one of the primary functions of the Framework Convention is to address collective action problems. And in the context of tobacco control, those collective action problems are, first, illicit trade in tobacco products, such as cross-border tobacco smuggling, such as counterfeiting, and also cross-border advertising, the transfer of advertising content via the internet, via cable TV, other mechanisms that in effect transfer tobacco promotion from one country to another. These are problems that require cooperation between states in question. Just as we've heard so much today about the need for a mechanism to address collective action problems in the context of R&D, and specifically the collective action problem of free riding, the circumstance where one state free rides on the investment carried out or put in motion by other states. So here we're talking about a similar type agreement, in effect, to discipline free riding or prevent it. Secondly, the Framework Convention on Tobacco Control serves a primary function of facilitating coordination on global tobacco control issues. Specifically in that context, we're talking about research and information exchange, and primarily research and information exchange relevant to regulation of the tobacco industry. Here, we are also talking about a coordination mechanism to address resource allocation, standard setting, including potentially harmonisation, decision making, and again, information exchange. So again, there are some parallels here in the sense that an R&D convention would also serve as a coordination mechanism, just as the Framework Convention on Tobacco Control does. Now, in political terms, the Framework Convention also serves some other functions. And one of those functions is to mobilise domestic and international interest groups, such as the tobacco control movement and the public health movement. An R&D convention although not in a formal sense, may serve the same function in the sense that it creates some social hub among domestic and international actors working on these issues, and it mobilizes them in terms of one direction, even though the convention may not, in fact, bind them directly. But it creates a forum that facilitates that kind of coming together within civil society and between governments. And then finally, another function carried out by or served by the Framework Convention on Tobacco Control is to establish social facts or cement international consensus around some shared ideas. And in the context of tobacco control, it sounds rather trite now, but it's true at the time the convention was negotiated. The convention really cemented the idea that tobacco and tobacco consumption was both a social and an economic bad. It's, in fact, in regulatory terms and in regulatory debates, it's a rather new concept to see that this has been accepted at the domestic level. And this is partly because the Framework Convention, as a binding international instrument, legitimised tobacco control. And in doing so, it's pushed tobacco control up the political agenda. And just today, we've heard a lot about, in particular, not just neglected tropical diseases, but also non-communicable diseases, and tobacco is one of the largest risk factors for non-communicable diseases. In the context of R&D, there's no doubt that a convention could also establish social facts or really cement international consensus around some core ideas, one of them being the failure of the IP system to generate sufficient innovation, and another being the value of delinking the price paid by consumers for a product and the investment in R&D. Now, these are concepts that have all been discussed this morning as if they are, in fact, now accepted. I would dare say that they're certainly accepted in some circles, but that a binding international convention negotiated under the auspices of the World Health Organization would go a lot further to really establish and cement these ideas as social facts and as a sort of stepping stone on the path forward towards further R&D to address the issues. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Benn, for giving that us the, I think, really astute parallels between the FCTC and any future framework convention on research and development. I think those ideas behind what a framework convention protocol approach can bring is very helpful. Our final speaker is Jamie Love. I think we just saw each other recently because we're talking about counterfeit medicines, and I'm chair of the Institute of Medicine's Committee on Counterfeit Medicines. And of course, one of the areas in counterfeit medicines is the idea of a global treaty. The European, not the Union, the European Union, but several European countries do have a treaty, and the question is whether or not it could be more broadly applicable. Jamie is the director of Knowledge Ecology International and also the U.S. co-chair of the Transatlantic Consumer Dialogue on Intellectual Property in the Intellectual Property Policy Committee. He's highly knowledgeable about these kinds of frameworks, so I'll turn it over to him.
Thank you, Professor Gostin, and thanks to Results for Development for Harvard, the Kennedy School, and the O'Neill Institute for including me in this session to talk about the Consultative Expert Working Group proposal for a research and development treaty. I want to first just sort of start with my understanding of, from my involvement, what's motivating this process a bit. Some people here have been involved for many years. I remember David was in a meeting in 2003 at the WHO where this was discussed, and so there's been a conversation for several years about whether or not the WHO may want to do some kind of an agreement on research development, and if not the WHO, some other body. I think there's two separate strands to this. There's one, there's a group of people that are concerned about the underfunding of research for diseases that predominantly affect people that live in developing countries, poor people that live in developing countries. And in the old days, we used to refer to that as the people that wanted a small treaty, the idea to sort of fill up funding gaps to focus on tropical neglected diseases, other types of priority research funding, and not to take on this sort of overall bigger picture of the R&D issues you might raise. People vary quite a bit about the specific details of what they might consider kind of a smaller treaty, but in general, funding was a really important part of all these things. And I think that you're never going to do this treaty or any other agreement like it if you don't believe that the funding gap is a problem. Some of the people that think there's a funding gap are just not too concerned because they think the Gates Foundation will essentially solve those problems. And actually, the fact that the Gates Foundation has been as generous as it's been and made such massive investments in these areas over the years has called into question to some people whether or not state action is really necessary, whether or not the charitable sector or Warren Buffett or somebody can just take care of this problem. I think it's the opinion of the people working on this issue that governments need to provide sustainable funding for research of this type, and that it's necessary not to have just the United States playing the outsized role it has historically, but to get more countries involved in it. That's one issue. It's important, the small treaty is important even as a small treaty because it essentially establishes R&D as a global public good in this particular space, and it sets a precedent. And with all this emphasis on delinkage, capacity building, technology trends, or openness, it sets norms which could migrate at some point to some other more ambitious targets in terms of the R&D agenda. Most people would agree that the sort of norms that are associated with a small treaty are really appropriate for things like tuberculosis research or malaria research or research on Chagas disease or things like that, because of the inability of the people who are the patients to pay for things, the lack of the difficulty in creating sustainable systems of care, and also the importance of access to knowledge on the upstream to enhance the R&D efforts in those areas. That said, as these things sort of migrate to other diseases, it really becomes I'm getting the two-minute mark here. Okay. So let me switch right now in my abbreviated discussion to the big treaty idea. The big treaty idea is that we are like a frog that's in a bottle of water or a pan of water on a stove. It's being turned up 1 degree at a time, and we're facing this increasing web of intellectual property agreements, trade agreements that go to drug pricing issues and things, all of which are designed at the global level to raise the price of drugs and strengthen the monopoly around life-saving medicines, and that where we are today is worse than where we were 5 years ago, is worse than where we were 20 years ago, and people are worried about where we're going to be 20 years from now. They're afraid that essentially we're creating a situation where institutionalizing and driving deeper into the fabric of the health system, the deep inequality of access to medicine, and a lot of the other inefficiencies that exist in the current system. So then, for those people, the idea of doing an R&D treaty is an attempt to build an alternative global mechanism to deal with the R&D thing other than just TRIPS, TRIPS Plus, TRIPS Squared, TPP, all these different measures that are going from patents to patent extensions to data to longer data exclusivity to everything else that's going along with it. That makes it quite confrontational and in theory with the big pharma companies. That's why for many years any work on these issues was blocked basically because it was feared to be so potentially revolutionary that it might probably taken more seriously by the drug companies than the NGO community, how the precedents might fit. I think the current state of play is that the drug companies have toned it down a notch. They're less concerned about the transformative revolutionary nature of a small treaty dealing with type 2, type 3 diseases. And the current reality is that now we're in financial crisis, and the high-income countries just don't want to pay or buy into a binding commitment to spend money on research and development when they're making very difficult and painful cuts at home and all sorts of other domestic programs. So the current problem is really not really about the IPR openness issues, which I think have become less controversial. The industry has really moderated its position on things. It's really at this point, is there enough money to go around? Is when you're struggling to keep the existing global fund on AIDS, tuberculosis, and malaria afloat and deal with the declining contributions there, is it time to start a brand new global fund, that sort of thing? And so I think that's really the current state of play. And I will conclude with a take on that last feasibility thing. One of the things that makes the current R&D proposal controversial is they propose a new global fund, a single global fund, of which 20% of the numbers that people would fund. For the United States, that would be a new obligation, even though the United States is way above average historically in how much they've spent in these areas. What we've recommended is that you abandon the idea of a single fund. You entertain the possibility that you have multiple qualified pool funds to manage the resources in this area, and that you allow the donors, including the United States, to choose the intermediary, the pool fund, to support their work, and you count the kind of projects that they're already funding, so that if a country that's already doing a lot would not really feel the pain of the agreement, it would essentially raise the level of effort by people that are doing less, that are not doing enough. It would be a way of leveraging the existing expenditures and trying to get other people to do more. That would be one thing. The other thing is to actually expand the scope of the treaty so it doesn't deal with just things that are perceived as transfers of income to developing countries, such as work on malaria or Chagas disease, but they include things that are considered to be legitimate priorities for R&D in high-income countries, such as antibiotics, for example, some areas of diagnostics where there's a joint interest in it, and other things that you create still a relatively small agreement, but you do something that's a little bit more ambitious where the benefits are perceived both north and south, and that you move ahead to try and establish a new paradigm for supporting R&D that's more sensitive to equality of access. And it pushes in this direction and builds this model of creating R&D as a public good. Thank you.
Okay. What I think we'll do now is I'll just address a few questions to the panel, and then we'll open it up to a broader discussion in the audience. But I also would like to invite the panel to ask questions of each other so that we actually get into a bit more of a dialogue. So let me start with you. You'd mentioned these four areas that were critically important for any global governance system, and I agree: affordability, sustainability of finance, efficiency, the fourth one was. That it has to be health need centered, of course, which is the most important. Do you think that those could be accomplished only by a framework convention or a hard legal instrument, or if not, what soft normative instruments like codes of practice or global strategies, or something like one could imagine a PIP framework. Does everybody know what the PIP framework is? The WHO's PIP framework. It's a. Very interesting cross between a soft and a hard instrument on the international sharing of benefits and burdens of influenza virus. You'll recall Indonesia refused to share its virus with the WHO. Director Chan spent many, many years trying to host a negotiation, and it became the PIP framework. What was interesting about the PIP framework is that it's a soft norm, but it's also based upon a contract. And pharmaceutical companies were part of that contract. And that it obliged them to give certain benefits. So that would be maybe a cross between a soft and hard norm. So how could you get those four elements into a soft norm, or would you only go for a hard norm?
That's a great question, and very much, I think, a law professor's question. So let me start with the first one, affordability. I think we've seen a lot of progress in the last 10 years on affordability of certain drugs, largely due to soft norms or informal norms. And HIV is the area where I think that progress is most dramatic and clear. But we've also seen the limits of that. We know that there are a number of countries, particularly middle-income countries, that are excluded from price discounts or from licenses, for example, to the medicines patent pool or direct bilateral licenses that allow countries to buy generic versions of patented drugs. We know that only some countries benefit from those types of programs or offers. We know that not all AIDS drugs are included, and certainly not all diseases are included. So I think what we've learned about affordability and soft norms is that, yes, you can get somewhere, but I don't think we're going to get nearly as far as we need to. We're not going to get to 100%, neither on country scope nor on diseases or drugs. So I think in order to have a truly affordable system, we need to implement something like a delinkage system, really at the global level, where everybody is willing to buy into that same system and finance R&D up front and have competitive production of the drugs coming afterwards. On sustainable financing, I think it's even, unfortunately, the record with soft norms is even weaker. There has been, of course, an incredible increase in global health financing over the last last two decades. But what we've also seen is that since 2008, with the financial crisis, the amount of donor funding in particular has dropped. And we know that, I think many people in this room know that the Global Fund is in major crisis right now as a result. And investment in neglected disease R&D, which had been increasing significantly over the last decade, has also dropped for the first time, as the GFinder report published last December showed. So soft norms have not proven to be sufficient to ensure sustainable or predictable financing, unfortunately. I wish that they had, because they are, in fact, easier to achieve, as we discussed earlier. Of efficiency, I do think it's possible for some actors and entities to embrace, for example, open access norms, to share knowledge, to put knowledge into the public domain. But again, it's going to be extremely partial and incomplete unless you have all countries on board. And we had the brief discussion this morning about the lack of information about what's happening in China. And I think that's a great it's a great example of what we'd like to do, is to have all countries buy into a system that would, in fact, deliver benefits for a global community, and not just have the NIH putting that knowledge into the public domain. And in terms of health-centered sort of a health-centered system, I think we're all familiar with the drawbacks of the existing system, so I won't go into too much there. But the one thing I would like to point out is perhaps one of the assumptions behind the R&D treaty perhaps might be that it has to be universal, that every single country has to be in. And I do think that, of course, having every country in means a bigger budget, it means more buy-in for the norms, it means more open sharing of knowledge. But sometimes having every country in can mean that the norms get watered down to a level that makes the binding instrument weaker or perhaps not even worth it. And it's interesting, I think, to think about models like UNITAID, which has managed to get a group of countries that are interested and willing to provide funding on a more sustainable basis. It's 30 countries that got together to do that and adopt a new model of financing for global health, which is based on an airline tax. It's interesting to think about those types of models as well and think about whether that would get us a lot closer to an improved R&D system.
Okay, thank you. Benn, you had mentioned, I thought, really three key ideas in the FCTC about why the FCTC could be negotiated, why it needed to be negotiated, why you couldn't do it on a country level, which is basically collective action or the need for cooperative action, mobilize civil society, provide a forum for government and civil society, and establish kind of scientific and social fact consensus, consensus on facts, but also consensus on norms, I think was your point. Do all of these apply with respect to the R&D treaty idea? And then secondarily, it's really a second question, Do you foresee any explicit or even implicit tension between the current WTO and TRIP system and any future framework convention? We know that that's occurred with the FCTC in a big way, and we know that the FCTC was silent on trade in a way that the IHR was not silent on trade. So reflect on those issues.
Thanks, Larry. So I guess I gave four explanations of the FCTC, and if we really dug deep and unpacked some of the international relations theory as to why states create regimes, we would see that some of these theories actually compete with one another and there are different underlying assumptions. But from my perspective, I like to think of these explanations as actually working together, and that some explanations will appeal to some states, whereas others will not. So if we look at the R&D Convention, from a sort of rational interest perspective, we have a classic cooperation problem, a problem where there's an incentive for states to defect in not providing funding to a system, but then taking the benefits in the form of the research and development downstream. And to prevent defection, the argument would be that you need some binding form of instrument to keep everyone in line, to prevent this type of free riding. And I think that sort of rationale or explanation for an R&D convention would appeal to some states more than others, depending on where they sit in that system, whether they are a funder or a free rider and what their sort of rational self-interest is. I think also that the parallels can be drawn in terms of facilitating coordination. I think in the context of R&D, there's a much greater need for coordination than there is in tobacco control. And we're talking a lot about the Framework Convention here, but there are many other treaties that are pure coordination mechanisms, that where they don't even seek to address a cooperation problem where one state might defect from the consensus. And I guess it's too soon to prejudge exactly which elements of the CEWG report might end up being accepted by WHO member states as a sufficient basis to move forwards, but I can see a lot of states being attracted to the idea of this being a central mechanism for coordination. But then also the question of mobilising domestic interests, I think, is a very important one here. In the context of tobacco control, the convention really created a central focal point through which the tobacco control movement and the public health movement could work in unison. And I could see the same thing happening in this context, because frankly, civil society will be forced to coalesce around a series of joint goals.
Yeah.
With respect to your question about TRIPS, for those who aren't familiar with it, the Agreement on Trade-Related Aspects of Intellectual Property Rights, which is a WTO-covered agreement. Jamie might want to say more about this as well. Do I see tension? I certainly don't see this proposal in any way being contradictory to TRIPS or conflicting with TRIPS. It wouldn't change that baseline international minimum standards required under TRIPS. I see it more as a new means of managing and incentivizing the creation of knowledge, and sort of dealing with it through a different stream rather than the sort of creation and protection of a private property right.
Well, thank you. Just jumping on what you said and then turning to Jamie, one could envisage, for good or bad, suppose 5 years from now we had an R&D treaty framework convention. One could imagine that you had two sets of funding mechanisms, one through the traditional modus operandi, another through the global one. Would there be another perverse incentive which is that states, for example, like the United States, which gave so much, might cut back so that we give no more, and also that the private sector would completely abandon any idea of kind of its social responsibility. In other words, it would free them to go after profit. This is for Jamie, but also for Jamie, you mentioned pools, multiple pools rather than one fund. If you had multiple pools, does that empower or disempower WHO? Either way, is that a good thing, or is it not? And do you see, what do you see the future of the Global Fund as a fund for TB, AIDS, and malaria exclusively, or something more?
Let me start with the issue you raised about the multiple funds, because I think that's the recommendation of the CEWG was for a global fund, a singular global fund, a pool fund. It's not a huge amount of money, but it is over $1 billion as is presented, assuming that you got 190 countries to sign up to it, and probably a lot less than $1 billion if you got fewer. So it isn't just the amount of money, but I think that from the point of view of the donors are concerned, I think that there's some reticence to locking in on any kind of a binding agreement, if it was a binding agreement, with something that required them to give money to a particular thing, because there's issues about the governance, the performance, inevitably that come up in this kind of thing. It may be hard to explain to their own finance ministers or the budget committees in the United States or whatever to do that. On the other hand, I mean, there's plenty of evidence that countries find particular projects they find really interesting. Like the Japanese, for example, really apparently are fond of funding projects on leprosy, for example. I'm not sure why, but there it is, right? And I think that the U.S. has shown this exceptionalism on AIDS, for example, and other things. And so I think that certain Latin American countries certainly feel that Chagas is more of a responsibility in that region than the Africans do. I think there's some benefits to allowing people to sort of pencil in the areas and the management and things like that that they want in terms of the thing. I think that there would be a higher willingness to contribute than if they thought they were just giving it to some alien NGO in Geneva, that, you know, packed with young people flying business class and, you know, kind of wasting away the assets like that in a growing bureaucracy. So I think that there is an advantage in allowing people to shop with their dollars and some competition among the funding mechanisms. Now, that said, these policies about delinkage, to the extent you can get agreement on IPR issues of like open access to government research or things like that, and technology transfer, I think part of the idea is to have global norms in those areas. So I think the way you combine the two is that a qualified pooled fund would have to follow the policies that are established by the centralized body. So the centralized body would establish policies, but not necessarily be the management and the implementation of the funding itself. That's how I would sort of separate the two out a bit. I think that may actually play to the strengths. Not everyone who's good at setting policy is good at necessarily executing some of the management of things anyhow. In terms of the sort of issue about binding versus non-binding, I think most of the negotiators who are involved in this do not believe you get any kind of agreement on any binding thing in the short run. I think what's more important is they sort of work out basically how much money they think is involved, what's sort of an appropriate thing, what policies, what the R&D observatory might look like, and in coordination, work in those details and sort of leave the issue of whether it's binding or not binding or how binding it is. Once there's a bit more confidence that they're comfortable with the actual outcome and they see that there's some benefits into them. Now, why would people want binding? Well, why do the drug companies want binding agreements every time they drop a hat? Why is the ACT a binding agreement? Why is the TRIPS a binding agreement? Why is the IPA a chapter 25 different bilateral trade agreements? Why is the proposal for a counterfeit thing pushed by drug company lobbyists initially, like such as Roger Bate and people? Why is that essentially proposed as a binding instrument? It's because they believe that binding instruments are powerful norm-setting things, and I think they're right about that. It doesn't mean necessarily that you have to start at that place, but I can understand why. And the other thing, as Suerie mentioned, the Global Fund is in a meltdown phase right now. They're canceling funding rounds and things like that, and a lot of people that said, when the movie stars were out, they said, yeah, I want to fund the Global Fund, are like not showing up now that they're in a, you know, now that incumbent governments are being thrown out and they're throwing people off of out of universities and things. So a non-binding agreement is really not taken as seriously when it comes to the funding. What the IPR agreements are is they say, you don't get the products unless you pay. And it's an agreement people make in a costless environment because the cost of the IPR agreements comes in future years. So trade negotiators enter this agreement. They do it because they think it's a feasible way to get people to invest in R&D because the benefits from the exclusivity. It's very painful and it's very unfair in developing countries. About 80% of the world's population is left out of those kind of arrangements in terms of access, so it's high, people are critical. Well, if you want to develop something to replace something like that, you have to be serious about the amount of money that you're talking about. Starting with type 2 thyroid disease is cheaper because it's a small part of the market. It's not threatening to big pharma because it's not where they make their profits. But it's a nice test of can you actually get people to pay if they don't have strong IPR staring them in the face. And so I think if you can't demonstrate that you can pay in type 2/3 diseases, I think it's a good case for saying, why do you think people would pay if they didn't have IPR agreements? In other words, I think it calls the bluff of people on our side, you know, that are saying you don't need the strong IPR agreements, because if you can't raise the money in the absence of strong IP in this agreement for type 2/3 diseases, maybe people are just not serious. Maybe they're not really willing to pay. And I think it's at the end of the day, you have to find a way to pay for R&D. And I think that that's the great thing about this report is they really focused on the money. And we've encouraged negotiators to see this as an issue of money, and the IPR issues will sort themselves out as they move along.
Okay, great. So how much time do we have for questions?
Just maybe one or two questions.
Just one or two questions. Okay, so any questions from the audience? Sure.
Hi, I'm Brian Collinsworth, Director of Universities Allied for Essential Medicines. I guess I'd like to hear, and Jamie spoke to this a little bit, but a little more about how you see the process going from here, the negotiation process, what challenges might arise, but also particularly if there are lessons from the way past conventions were negotiated that might be applicable here.
If there are no more questions, I'll make that the last one and just invite the panelists to close, because that would be a good way for us to close the panel. Who would like to start? Okay, sure.
There are certainly many lessons learned in the context of the Framework Convention on Tobacco Control. But the short answer is the first hurdle is the World Health Assembly and the question of whether or not WHA is going to endorse next steps to take this proposal forward, whether that be in the form of an intergovernmental working group or some full-scale negotiation. The lawyer inside of me says, having witnessed legal negotiations at WHO, that the primary lesson is to bring the lawyers. As sad and as shocking as that might be for people who work in public health.
I'm good with that.
I think one of the transformative things about the CEWG report is really how it puts a responsibility on government. And IPR is very much a north-south issue. The debates have been, I think, for good reason, divided along those lines. What I see coming out of the R&D debates is maybe something more similar to tobacco, where it's really about health advocates within various countries and perhaps having to argue against finance ministries, against trade ministries, against others who are not in favor of investing a country's resources in this way. And so I think the politics will shift in an important way. But my hope is that at the WHA, governments will get it together and demonstrate that they are, in fact, up to the task that's been put before them. If I can make one closing remark about WHO, you raised the question of what should WHO do and will certain options weaken WHO. I think the issue of WHO reform is at the front of many people's minds these days for a very good reason. The question of what functions ought to be carried out within the WHO secretariat, I think, do deserve careful thought and negotiation. And whatever functions are asked to carry out should, of course, be financed in a way that is appropriate to carry out those functions. And that's not been the way that WHO has been financed in the past. But the one thing that I think there ought to be no controversy about is what is the arena within which governments can negotiate these rules. And in my view, there is no replacement for WHO as the most legitimate and inclusive arena for governments to come together and work out these problems. And I think it's really a big test of leadership for the WHO, as well as for all the member states that we'll be gathering in a couple weeks.
Thank you. Jamie, did you want to make any final comment and then bring it to a close?
Thank you. I would encourage people to, in one hand, this is really a discussion about whether you can have a sustainable agreement about governments to do more for diseases that predominantly affect people who live in developing countries, something that's been widely recognized for a long time. It's an underfunded thing. Even the Gates Foundation really doesn't present itself as the entity that's able to solve the problem in the long run. And I think that this is a test to see whether or not there's a real commitment that involves dollars and cents to do something about it. Another way, though, to look at this debate, and I think it's important that people look at it, it's really a bigger debate about the delinkage issue. This is a political demand by a number of public health groups and patient advocates and an increasing number of governments to look beyond the idea, the historic idea, that you grant time-limited monopolies and you accept high prices. I wish you could have heard John-Arne's presentation on the sort of high price thing he presented in Geneva last week, and he had a bit more time. But I think that this idea that you rely upon high prices as the be-all and end-all for funding research in the medicine area by the private sector, and that the international agreements are only about the private sector, that's the other thing, is being challenged. And it's being challenged by all sorts of people. In one of the slides that Jan presented last week in Geneva, it was a quote from the head of the European Federation of Pharmaceutical Industries, I forget the exact initials for it, where he called for the idea of using innovation prizes and delinkage in Europe is a way of stimulating development of new antibiotics. And there was a Council of Europe recommendations on pursuing this idea of disassociation of R&D cost and linkage. Last week, the United States Senate Help Committee adopted language requiring the national academies to do a fairly extensive study of the use of innovation inducement prizes as a way of delinking the cost of R&D from either AIDS drugs, antibiotics, or other types of drugs in the United States. The UNITAID has taken interest in the delinkage thing. It's in part of the global plan, and it was at the center, really, of the CEW. Now, what does that really mean? It just means that the feeling is, at least with medicines and vaccines and possibly other medical technologies, you can escape the idea that high prices and unequal access is the core instrument used to fund R&D. Now, I have to ask yourself, if you really care about poor people, if you really care about access, if you really care about human rights, as I think almost everybody in this room does, how could you not see that as a historically big goddamn important debate that has to go down the right way? You have to be fighting for it to go the right way. It's really an important debate. And I'll tell you, a major disappointment is the leading institution in this area that's funding almost all groups working in global health right now is the Gates Foundation. The Gates Foundation has been silent, completely silent, on this issue. For a while, we had a poll on why the Gates Foundation opposed the R&D treaty because the secretariat was telling people that he did. And Bill Gates was questioned about it in India, and he denied that they had a position one way or the other on the thing. At a meeting last week in Seattle of the big meeting they had of the PDP groups out there that do R&D, only DNDi raised the R&D treaty proposal in the meeting with Gates and with the Gates Foundation groups out in Seattle. And for this meeting, it's my understanding that none of the Gates, the primarily Gates-funded PDP organizations, were willing to appear on these panels to talk about the R&D treaty. I'm not saying the Gates Foundation is opposed to this, but if people think he's opposed to it, that's going to change the way a lot of people act toward this thing. And I think it's really, really important, because this chance to challenge the basic paradigm doesn't come about every day. This is not a debate you're going to have. If it goes wrong and it goes poorly this time, you're not going to be able to come back 3 years from now, and basically it's going to be very difficult to breathe life back into it again. So I encourage people to engage in this and to make things move forward and to check and do a bit of reality check where people stand. And if you're not on the right side of it, explain what your scenario is to have equal access to medicine for poor people around the world, for the rest of the global population, if you don't go down the delinkage route. What is the alternative to delinkage? Thank you.
Janani.
If I was allowed to just give a short comment in the end, and I would just have three issues. So related to efficiency of the system, Nils Daulaire alluded to this. I think it's really important that we also need to look at how we invest money. I, on the flight back from Geneva on Saturday, I read a book by a historian, Kendall Hoyt, called Long Shot. It's a recent book published a couple of months ago on the vaccine development in the US, and particularly from a defense perspective, and securing kind of investments to prevent bioterrorism. And she really demonstrates how we need a better and more efficient system. Even if we have much more expertise now, the system seems to produce much less vaccines now than it used to do kind of the first 30, 40 years in the last 70 years. So I think all countries and all stakeholders needs to increase efficiency. Second, on the pooled funding, I think James spoke about Gates' position. At least what is true is that Bill Gates is among the most strongest proponents towards more increased public funding. He's told this in many different fora, last kind of very outspoken in the G20 meeting. So I think there's support on that side from the Gates Foundation. We need pooled funding, partly due to direct mechanisms, and that's partly related to coordination. I think the arguments for actually improved coordination is stronger within R&D than probably almost any other sectors, and we have managed to do pooled funding when it comes to buying commodities like Unit Aid, partly Global Fund, partly Gavi, and also kind of supported the delivery of healthcare services. Why shouldn't we be able to kind of agree on that here? But then it's the indirect benefits of pooled funding. I think you shouldn't downplay the indirect benefits, because pooled funding will mean that all countries will need to be more transparent. More transparent on the resources they're using, more clear on the principles they are using, and thereby creating a better monitoring system, kind of indirectly due to the pooling. And finally, I came into this process as some kind of medical doctor, I would say, a physician and an idealist. If I turn into a kind of international relations realist type of guy, I would say, and if I divide the world up in four constituencies, I think all should agree to moving forward. And why? First, US. US really gets the benefits here, because it's a matter of just getting the others on board and invest in the level where the US does today. And then the kind of amount of global public goods, the amount of R&D outputs will really increase. I think when it comes to for the European Union and other high-income countries, they really need to step up. And one issue, and it was partly alluded to by Jamie, if we also look into the needs for antibacterials or antibiotics, which are exactly the same failures of the system as we see for R&D for neglected diseases, I think we can at least discuss whether to expand and focus on those needs within a framework. Then you have a clear health benefit also for high-income countries within the framework. Third, BRICS countries. I think they are really, really need to step up in financing. And they also need to be more transparent on how they invest today. And what are their benefits? Their benefits is that they can increase innovative capacity and research capacity, and also really benefit from increased manufacturing capacity in these competing economies. And finally, developed countries, the really, really countries in need, they would really see this as a breakthrough if we are able to succeed. Finally, maybe just to acknowledge Jamie Love's real contributions in this area for many, many years. I would like, because you gave me the idea, you talked about the small treaty. So what can be seen as kind of a small treaty for Jamie Love is a big kind of step for mankind. Thanks to all of you, and thanks for coming. Then final word from Jean.
Great, thank you everybody. On behalf of Results for Development Institute, I just want to thank all of the panelists, our co-hosts at the O'Neill Institute, and the Harvard Global Health Institute for today's event. We've heard a lot about needs, current efforts, norms, and the consensus that's emerging around norms in this area. And there's been a lot of debate about practicalities today. We've been reminded that a lot of progress has been made, but this is a long process, and we're at an auspicious moment. So we very much look forward to this debate being part of a longer debate at the World Health Assembly and going forward into the practicalities of moving from soft norms into thinking about alternatives and binding instruments. And here at Results for Development Institute, we will be following the debate. So thank you so much to everyone, and have a great afternoon.